Subject this morning is reincarnation, and I approach this subject with fear and trembling. Fools rush in where angels fear to tread, because this is the most discussed subject there is, and it's the subject of which the least is known about, because it's the most guarded secret of God, reincarnation. Because on that hinges all the play of his drama of life. Because if we knew that secret, there'd be nothing to it. But still, through the help of the beloved Master and his grace, I have seen one or two instances which I'll tell you about, so that as far as I'm concerned, that is, I feel that reincarnation is a fact. And so the subject is finding the truth about reincarnation. In this subject, I will give you some Bible references, a reference from the Gita, one or two personal experiences, that you may judge as to the truth of reincarnation. First, what is reincarnation? What does reincarnation mean? Reincarnation means a pilgrimage of the soul. Pilgrimage of the soul until all of its desires are fulfilled, worked out, and it returns to the place from whence it came. These are the Master's words. It is a pilgrimage. Now, the pilgrimage takes place in the drama of life. The pilgrimage is in this dream of God. The soul itself is old. The soul came from the prehistoric Christ consciousness, came long before creation. But in this creation, it manifests first in lowly forms, in the minerals, then in the vegetable kingdom, in the animal kingdom, and finally in the highest form as a human being. Now the soul is the same through the whole thing. Through the pilgrimage, the soul is the same, complete. But just a little part of it begins to manifest in the lower kingdoms. Finally, it manifests to its fullest extent through the intellect and the mind as a human being. But then, to know the soul, from there on, we have to know the soul not by the intellect, but by the intuition. There comes in involution. And man, being the highest form, has the power to introspect and through involution know this prehistoric Christ consciousness, which ever was and ever will be. That is what our soul is. But when the soul is identified to the vehicle, like this body or your body or this animal or that animal, it takes on the characteristics it's limited by the vehicle. Therefore, it's difficult to understand that behind that is the one prehistoric, all-knowing Christ consciousness, which we all are. Because in Proverbs, in the 8th chapter, it says this. The 8th chapter of Proverbs, it says in the 22nd and 23rd verse, "The Lord possessed me in the beginning of his way, before his works of old." The Lord is the Christ consciousness, as I have said. "I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning, before the world was." So that is what reincarnates. That is what makes the pilgrimage. Only it's in the drama of life, it's in delusion. You see only a part of it in the animal kingdom, in the vegetable kingdom. You see a great part of it manifesting in the human being. But to understand it fully, you have to go beyond the intellect, beyond the mind, beyond the senses, into the intuition of the soul itself. Then, by being one with that prehistoric Christ consciousness, you can know not only your past lives, but the lives of everyone. So, that's what the soul is. That gives you a different idea The fact is, it's attached to this transient body, or the body of each and every one of us, or the body of every animal, or every little crystal. That is what throws us off. That is what makes it difficult. But when you lift your consciousness into the all-pervading consciousness of Christ, then you know it is a ray of that soul manifesting as the mineral, metal, animals, vegetables, and finally as human beings. But we, being made in the image of God, have the power to know that one great soul, the Christ consciousness. So there, in a few words, is what happens in reincarnation. When it says, as I read, the Lord, it means the Christ consciousness. This is the same pre-existing Christ consciousness which spoke and appeared to Abraham, David, Joseph, Daniel, Ezekiel, Zechariah, all the prophets. It's the one great consciousness of God. But being attached to the body of David or Abraham or Ezekiel or Zechariah, we apply it to them, not realizing that it is eternal. That is what our soul is, each and every one of us. We are not differentiated and separated. We're only separated by attachment to this body, circumscribed, limited by the vehicle. Remember that. That'll give you a definite idea of just what you are, what the soul is, and what incarnate. Now passing on, what is it that accompanies the soul as it travels from one body to another? What is it that goes? We know it isn't this body, because this body stays here and disintegrates, passes back to the earth and so forth. Therefore, it must be what is left. What goes on with the soul as it goes from one body to the other is the spiritual body of life plus the causal body of God's thoughts which are producing it. The spiritual body has 19 elements, 10 senses, the 5 pranas which you've heard me speak of, those great forces which keep us alive and make us human beings, plus the mind, the intellect, the citta or emotions, and ego. Those in subtle form, those things in subtle form, like the seed. In the seed is the great tree. So, in the spiritual body in subtle form are those things. Those pass on, plus the causal body wherein we have the elements of the ideas of God which have produced the spiritual and the physical body. Now those things, those 19 elements pass on, plus traces or tendencies which we carry with us from our action in each life. Is that clear? When you live this life, I live this life, I have certain characteristics and tendencies, I do certain actions. Now those leave traces. It is those things that are carried on from one body to the next. That's why you will see the difference in people. Some will have certain tendencies, some will have another. Why? Because they carried them on. And that's how, if you are fortunate enough to have friendship with one like the beloved master, he can show you someone who has reincarnated being someone else. You will see those definite tendencies. Now, we had a gentleman in Boston. He passed away. He was a very wonderful man. And I used to ask the master, where is so-and-so? He says, well, he's still resting. He hasn't been born yet. After a while, he says, yes, he's born now. Now, in him, you will see the same characteristics that he had in a previous life. Now, coming a little nearer home in my own family, I'm saying these things just to help you, not from any egotistical standpoint, but my mother passed away. And after a little bit, he said, your mother is born again. I said, fine. He says, she's in Maine. I said, fine. And later, I was able to see in my mother those same characteristics that she had. You can see in her looks, in her action. Furthermore, I don't want to say, but that much I will tell you, that having the good fortune to be with the Master and have those things happen, to me, reincarnation is a truth and a fact. Now going on just a little bit, what is it that causes rebirth? Soul to come back, it is desire. As long as we have desire, we have to come back, take another vehicle, go on, until we get out of the wheel of births and death. Jesus had the desire to do what? Not perhaps the desire you and I have, but he had the conscious desire to do God's will. That's why he came back. That's the way you and I must come back, not through compulsion. But we must know that prehistoric Christ consciousness, be one with it, realize our oneness with God, then we can come back as Jesus did. Fully realizing, as I will try to show in the scripture, fully realizing that he was playing a definite part in God's great play of life. Now, one of the greatest arguments for reincarnation is the injustices, the inequalities we see in life. I'll have to skip over it fast because it's a vast subject. But we see certain children born, they live just a short time. We see others born, they live full life. Some are born in wonderful families, spiritual families, lots of money. Others have nothing. Why? Then we see different people. Some people have social position. Some have wonderful opportunities. Some have good health. Some can make money. They just touch a thing and it turns into gold. Others, they have good intellects. They're wonderful people. They can't make a dime, so to speak. Why? Why? Why is this so? Then we have the case of outstanding people, musicians, artists. And I remember one boy came to the house, a Hindu boy, and he could multiply 60 digits times 60 mentally. Imagine it, 60 figures. 60 figures times 60 mentally. So he said to me, he said, when were you born? I says, what's the date of your birth? I says, March 26, 1893. He says, you were born on Sunday. I says, fine, that's wonderful. Boy, he says, that's nothing. He says, you take six figures. I put six figures on a paper. I put another, he says, take six more. I put six more on. He says, multiply them together. So I got my pencil out, and he said, your answer is such and such. I didn't even get started. And he says, any time within a year, you ask me, and I'll tell you that sum. There's a multiplication there. So he says, well, I said, how do you do it? He said, well, I see those things just like a blackboard. I see those, and I begin to multiply mentally. And he multiplied 60 digits times 60. I think it was in Columbia and Oxford. Now, how does that happen? That just doesn't happen. There is a cause of that. That is the result of karmic law, cause and effect. He is just where he is, as you and I and every one of us are, because of our previous lives and our previous actions. You cannot escape. Now going on, we see those differences. How about you see the difference in temperament, capacity, and evolution of different men in the same family, born under the same conditions and the same training? These things cannot be explained except through reincarnation. Then another thing, you take 70 years of sin or virtue, certainly cannot throw any of us into hell or heaven. And how about the man who has about 50% good karma and 50% bad karma? What's he going to do? Stay 6 months in Hades and 6 months in heaven? How are you going to? You cannot explain it that way. It's impossible. And also, wouldn't God be partial? Wouldn't he be partial if he created some of us fortunate and some of us unfortunate? Yes, he would. We're here because of a previous action. And we're here because we have deserved just what we have got, according to the laws of God's great creation. And surely a finite life cannot give an infinite life. There's no question about that. We've got to right now, know the infinite part of us, know the Christ consciousness from which we have come, be one with that, then we will know all our previous lives. Not only our lives, the lives of everyone, because they are all in that great consciousness of Christ, the Christ consciousness, God himself in creation. Everything is there. The thing is, remember, we are sidetracked and identified with the vehicle, not the doer, not the one who is playing this drama of life. Now going on just a little, I will have to burden you just a bit with a few Bible references. You know, in America here, we want facts. We just don't want to be told certain things. We want to know about it. So I will hurry through this, and those of you who can take down the references, I advise you to do so. And then read them. Read them, and then you will understand about reincarnation in a much clearer way. Our first reference now is, the first reference is Matthew, the 17th chapter. The 17th chapter, the 12th and 13th verses. Matthew, the 17th chapter, the 12th and 13th verses. Now this has to do with reincarnation. Here we read, "But I say unto you, that Elias is already come." Jesus said this. Elias is already come. Now Elias, you know, was Elijah. He was called Elijah. You read in Kings, in the Old Testament, you will read that Elijah was spoken of as Elias. So Jesus says, Elias is already come, and they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they wanted to. Likewise shall they also do unto the Son of Man. Then the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. John was Elijah, or Elias. He came as John the Baptist. That's the first. Now I have given you a few references in the Bible interpretation this morning about John being the guru of Jesus. There you learned, or you understood, that John was previously Elijah, the guru of Jesus. At that time in the Old Testament, Jesus was Elisha. As I will point out, Elijah found Elisha. The Lord told him to go and look him up and find him, which he did. And what happened? Then he anointed him. He anointed him with his spirit. His mantle of spirit. So going on, we find in the First Kings, the 19th chapter, First Kings, 19th chapter, the 15th, 16th, and 19th verses, just what I have told you. Now I will not read it all, but I will just give you the gist and you folks can look it up. 19th chapter, 15th, 16th, and 19th verses. It says, "And the Lord said unto him, Go." He's speaking to Elijah. "And meet certain people, do certain things. Then he said, And you will find Elisha, the son of Shaphat. And what shall you do? Thou shalt anoint him to be a prophet in thy room." So there we have the direction of Elijah to find Elisha. And what to do? To give him his mantle of spirit. And we will see the reason in a few minutes. Then it says, "And so Elijah departed and found Elisha plowing with 12 yoke of oxen, and he with the 12. And Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle of spirit upon him." And so there you have what happened. Jesus received the mantle of spirit of Elijah. He received his spiritual perception because he was his guru. He was his guru. Now in the 20th verse, we read, that is, after receiving the mantle of perception from Elijah, it says he returned home. And then the people arose, and they went after Elijah. Then Elisha went after him and ministered unto him, after he had received his mantle of spirit. Now going on just a little bit. In the second chapter, 2 to 6 verses, here we read that Elijah is testing Elisha. The guru tests the disciple, that he may be strong and may rise above delusion. Now Elijah tried to get Elisha to leave him, in several instances. There are four instances between the second and sixth verses, which I will not read. He tried to get him to leave him. He says, no, I won't. Because he knew. He knew what was in store from him. Elisha knew that he had to pass through the crucifixion. Be crucified. He knew the test was coming. Because after he received the mantle of perception from Elijah, then he knew he was to come again and go through this and be crucified. You say, how? Because then didn't he ask Elijah for a double portion of it, that he might stand what he knew was coming. When Elijah cast his mantle of perception upon him, Elisha knew that he would come again as Jesus and be crucified, dead, and buried, and so forth. He knew that. He knew that. He also knew that 12 oxen represented that, the 12 disciples. Then he said, Elijah, do something for me. Elijah said to him, I will do what you want. And Elisha said, give me a double portion of spirit that I may stand and go through this great test, which I shall have to do when I come again as Jesus. And so in 2 Kings, read that second chapter, 2 to 6 verses, you will read about how Elijah tested Elisha. And then from the 9th to the 15th, you will also read how, finally, Elisha received the double portion of spirit, how by being able to keep his attention on Elijah, not leave him until Elijah ascended into heaven, then Jesus, Elisha, received a double portion of spirit. It says, finally, in the 15th, and when the sons and prophets which were to view Jericho saw him, they said, the spirit of Elijah doth rest on Elisha. And they came to meet him and bowed themselves to the ground before him. By Elisha being able to perceive Elijah going up in the whirlwind, which is the Kundalini power, which took him up to heaven, by Elisha being able to perceive that, what did he receive? He received all the perceptions which Elijah had in that particular life. And so he had the power and he had the strength to go through that great test, which he would have to do, as we read about in the New Testament. So after Jesus received the mantle of spirit from Elijah, then you will notice by reading in the different places in 2 Kings, the 4th chapter, about the 32nd to 34th verses, the 42nd to the 46th verses, there we find that Jesus performed the same type of miracles of raising the dead and of feeding the 5,000, which we read about in the New Testament. He did the same type of miracle which he did later in the New Testament, which you are familiar. So we see the same characteristics brought over. John had the same raiment. Jesus did the same type of miracle. These are most interesting things. And so finally, as to the Bible references, we read John came to see Jesus. Why? He said he came to be with him through his trial. Now many people say, well, if John was Jesus' guru in the previous life as Elijah, why wasn't he greater than Jesus in this New Testament era we read about? That's an important point. Now, every realized soul is the same in the great light of God. Now, in a previous life, Elijah was greater, no doubt. You read in the Old Testament. But in the New Testament, we find that John, who was Elijah, took a different part, a secondary part. And Jesus manifested, as I have said, completely the great prehistoric Christ consciousness to the fullest extent. Therefore, he was taking that part. But in the light of God, there's no difference between them. Just in that particular incarnation, John was less, according to our views, than Jesus was. But really, they are just the same. Remember that now when you compare some saint with another. No, the comparison is in you, not in the light of God, they are the same. So that's one thing used to bother me. But thank God I understand it now. I hope you do. Now we read also in Matthew, the 14th, this is important, in rather Matthew, the third chapter, the 11th verse, we read as follows. Third chapter, the 11th verse. Now, John knew Jesus was coming. I'm trying to show you that fully realized people know what's going on. They know what's going on. John knew Jesus was coming. And there we read, Matthew the 3rd, the 11th verse, I indeed baptize you with the water of repentance, but he that shall come after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Jesus came to manifest the great consciousness of Christ, the prehistoric consciousness of Christ. So there you have. John knew Jesus was coming, and Jesus also knew that his guru had come. And this we read in Matthew, the 17th chapter, the 12th verse. The 17th chapter, the 12th verse, this is what we read. But I say unto you, Jesus is speaking, that Elias is already come. Elias is already come. And they knew him not, but have done unto him as they like. Then he said, then the disciples knew that he spoke of John the Baptist. Jesus knew that his guru had come. And going on, finally, completing the reference in the Bible, Jesus knew that the law of guru to disciple must be fulfilled, so that when he saw John, he wanted him to baptize him. And John said no. Jesus said yes, because this is the way of all righteousness. And John also showed his great regard for Jesus when he said in Matthew the 3rd chapter, the 11th verse, he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. There was Jesus, who manifested fully the Christ, said about John the Baptist. Or John the Baptist said about Jesus. Then what did Jesus say? He said, there is no man born of woman as great as John the Baptist. So you see the relationship between two fully liberated souls as Jesus and John is to realize that there's no inequality in the great light of God. The inequality comes from little people. And you will find that last reference in Matthew, the 11th chapter, the 11th verse. When Jesus spoke about John, no man born of woman is great as my guru. That's how we feel toward our guru, isn't it? That's how Jesus felt toward him. Going on now with references to reincarnation in the scriptures. In the Bhagavad Gita, in the fourth discourse, the fifth line, there we read how Krishna, speaking to Arjuna, said, many lives we have been here, have come and gone. I remember all of mine, but you, O Arjuna, do not remember yours. Those who are one with the prehistoric Christ consciousness, they know all their past lives, just as all saints know the past lives, their own and others. So all who merge in that prehistoric Christ consciousness know all previous lives of all saints as well as their own. The only argument against reincarnation is that this is the only life which we know. We have no memory of past lives,
and the future seems unknowable. The favorite expression is, no one ever came back to tell us about the other side. This, of course, is so in the majority of cases. As I have said, reincarnation is God's deepest secret, but it is knowable when we become one with Him, one with His Christ consciousness. Jesus, you know, came back. Some of the disciples touched Him. He ate with them. Bawaji appeared in different places. The great Larity Masha also showed that his soul could be in more than one body. Sri Yukteswarji came back and appeared to the beloved master. And so memory is not a positive deciding factor in the matter of reincarnation, whether it is true or not. Because most of us cannot remember even our childhood days. While saints, some of them retain their consciousness after death, through birth, and then go right on without a break in the continuity of consciousness. Now one or two more interesting facts about reincarnation. Evolutional reincarnation. Evolutional reincarnation starts from the crystals and reaches the human sphere of existence. 8 million years are we in the animal body. Then the soul passes to the body of man. And so we can see that reincarnation is the retrograde stages through which the spirit returns to itself. The one spirit became many through evolutional processes and now returns to itself. A metallic soul, a vegetable soul, a human soul. Herein the bodies are different, but the soul is the same. There are different rays of that one great prehistoric Christ consciousness, the soul of all things, manifesting a little bit in the minerals to a great extent in human beings. Now as to reincarnation and spiritualism. In spirit possession, two souls possess one body. In reincarnation, one soul passes from one body to another in different births. And so we come to the final question, how can reincarnation be understood? Reincarnation cannot be intellectually understood. One has to experience a state of conscious death. By the techniques of self-realization, concentration, and meditation, we pass into that state of conscious death, wherein we are expanded beyond the limitations of this body and merge in the one prehistoric Christ consciousness. Self-realization techniques will give you this realization if you do them. The master once said to a group of disciples, he said, dye them in Kriya Yoga. When they show a little interest, give them the Hong Star technique, the Om technique, and these are auxiliaries to Kriya Yoga. Then later, as they take the preceptors and read them, then they will understand why they do these techniques. And so, in conclusion, we must break this dream of God, wherein the pilgrimage of the soul is taking place. We must break it by being one with the dreamer. We want to reincarnate on earth as Jesus did, of his own free will, not as a matter of compulsion. Free the soul from karma's law, which binds it, and lift the chain of forced reincarnation. The prehistoric Christ consciousness contains all things. All waves of life are potentially there. Saint and all. Who can be one with that consciousness can know not only their past lives, but the lives of all. I have a letter from Larry Marsh's grandson, Ananda Larry. And in that, he read some of the things Larry Marsh had said. And this is the thing Larry Marsh said. He said that by merging in this one omniscience of God, prehistoric Christ consciousness, being one with his omniscience, being one with the universal power of sight of the single eye of spirit, then we can know not only our past lives, but we can know the lives of all the saints, Jesus and Larry DeMarsh. We can even be one with Jesus. We can be a Christ. We can be a Larry DeMarsh. And so, dear friends, you have the truth now about reincarnation. Our problem, our duty, our task is to merge in that Christ consciousness which is manifesting in each one of us, in the stones, in the vegetables, in the animals, and in us. When we merge in that, then we can know not only our past lives, but the past lives of all. And greatest of all, we can merge and be one with Jesus, the great master, our beloved guru, Larry Marshall, and all the liberated saints.